I love what Lance Ivey said two Sundays ago. He said, light never asks darkness permission to shine. Light just shines because that's the nature of light. It shines. But there's something else that I've learned about light, and that is when light comes into a dark place, darkness has to go. Dark and light can't coexist. When light comes, darkness goes. When light leaves, darkness comes. And we are the light of the world. You are the light of the world. Not because you desire to attain that title, not because you've earned the right, but because Jesus said, you are the salt of the earth, you are the light of the world. Not someday, not tomorrow, not when you join a church, not when you join a religion, not when you learn more about God, but because you've accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you are light. I am salt of the earth. I am the light of the world. I want you to say that with me. Say it together. I am the salt of the earth. I am the light of the world. Often we look for the big things to do. We want to do something big for God. We want to reach the millions. We want to reach the nations. When in reality, what God has called us to do is just shine. Just shine. And if we're willing to do the small things, small acts of faith, small steps of faith, small witnesses of our relationship with God, if we're willing to do that, God will take care of the rest of it. But as we saw in this clip, this young man, two acts. One, by just reaching down and helping that young man that had been bullied, pushed down, helping him up and letting the light shine, and then just a bucket of paint to a little girl that's making a backdrop for a program. But as a result of those two small acts, and we would look at that and say, that's insignificant. What difference in the world will that make anywhere? And yet, if you are the light, people are witnessing the light in you. People are watching us. Whether we recognize it or not, whether we see it or not, people are watching us. They're watching our attitudes. They're watching our actions. They're listening to our words. And if we reflect the light, I think I've mentioned this song every Sunday throughout the month of November. This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine. Even as children in the church, we were taught that we are the light of the world. And we are taught, too, not to hide it under a bushel. No, I'm going to let it shine. Don't let Satan hit out. I'm going to let it shine. We're taught that as children. We're taught that as children, the light of Christ has invaded the darkness of our heart, and now we are changed. I once was in darkness, but I have seen a great light. But not only have I seen that light, but that light bears witness in my spirit. We're looking for the big things, waiting for the big things. The Bible teaches us clearly that if we're faithful in the small things, a helping hand to somebody, a kind word, a bowl of soup, a glass of cold water, a small thing that we're willing to do as light, not just acts of kindness, more than that, more than just doing. An act of kindness is a wonderful thing. It's a good thing. But how much more when we add three small little words, Jesus loves you. I watched that clip. I've seen it many times now, but I've watched that clip, and I watched this young man, each person watching the act of kindness, and in motivating them. See, that's what happens. When light invades darkness, it changes the darkness. When people see the light of Christ in us, it changes their perspective. They see the light. And I saw that man, he walks across the street, and there's this lady pushing a baby stroller, and the baby had thrown the toy out on the ground, the sidewalk, and the man reached down, and he picked it up, and he gave it to the baby. And that's a good thing. But how much more powerful would it be and greater witness would it be to add three little words? Words that don't cost us a thing, don't take any more time, but three little words that can make a big difference. Jesus loves you. We're not secret agents for Jesus. We live our life openly. That's what light is. John Hagee said, we are indeed the light of the world, but only if our switch is turned on. Turn on the switch. Turn it on. The light is in you. Why would we cover it up? Why would we let Satan blow it out? The blowing of Satan is not to squelch the, the light in you. It's not to destroy your witness. The enemy just desires you to believe that you're not enough light. You can't make a difference. Look at the end of that clip, and what you see is a whole group of people, one little boy whitewashing a wall, and all of a sudden, all of the people that were touched by two acts of kindness, all of them were touched, came, and they began to help. That's what happens. One light lights another light. One candle lights another candle. We did this on Wednesday night in our Wednesday night encounter. One light lights another. Here's what I've discovered about that. If I have a candle and I light another candle, it doesn't diminish my light at all. Yeah, it doesn't work that way with many things. If I have $10 and I give away $10, I've got nothing. If I've got $10 and I give away $5, I have $5 less. But if I'm the light and I give the light to somebody else, I still have the light. But now, the light is brighter. Not necessarily the light in me, but now where there was one light, now there's two lights. And we saw how that grew as we started with two candles and lit the candles around the room. In West Campus, we did the same thing on Thursday night. And in West Campus, it's a little more dramatic because the room was very dark. One candle. I lit my candle, and as I was sharing the word, I held that candle, and it was dark. You could see my face because the candle would illuminate my face. But I went to the first person at the table, and I lit their candle, and I said, I am the light of the world. Then I took my candle, still lit. That person lit the next candle, and the next, and the next, and the next, until all of a sudden around all of those tables there was light. You are the light of the world. Not tomorrow, not someday, today. If you've accepted Jesus Christ, you are the light of the world. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 8 says, in the past you were full of darkness. How many have testified to that? My life was full of darkness. But now you are full of light in the Lord. We're not talking about what we were. We're talking about what we are today. So live like children who belong to the light. Another translation says, so act like children of the night. Act like it. Live like it. Don't let the enemy think that you're not making a difference. Don't let the enemy think that your light is too small. Don't let the enemy make you think or make you believe that the darkness is greater than the light. Darkness always flees in the presence of light. We not only received light, but we've been made light. We have become transmitters of that light. I want you to turn to Matthew chapter 5. We're going to read, we've read this scripture each Sunday. In fact, each service during the month of January. Our theme this year is salt and light. I am the salt of the earth. I am the light of the world. One of the best teachings I've ever heard on salt was a teaching by Lance Ivey 2 weeks ago. If you were not here and didn't have benefit of that teaching, I would encourage you to go to our website. There's a link there where you can watch the video, listen to the video, or go to Vimeo. There's different venues that you can find our services on. And 1045 service is streamed, live stream. But go back and listen to Lance Ivey, one of the best teachings I've ever heard on salt. And then I understand that Wednesday night, Brother Isaac Pomago was here, and he spoke on salt as well. So we've had some real intense training on what salt is. But today, I want to talk about light. Would you bow your heads with me, please? Father, we come to you today, and we are grateful to you that you brought light into our lives. Father, I thank you that we're about to read your word. The most important words that will be spoken in this service today are these. These are your words. They're not a word of a committee or a religion. They are the words of God. Jesus said, my words are truth, and I believe that with all my heart. And as we read this word, I pray, Holy Spirit, that you bring revelation to our life. We've all encountered different things throughout the week, and we will encounter different things in the week to come. But Heavenly Father, you are always with us, and you watch over us. And I pray, Holy Spirit, make these words alive in us so that we just don't acknowledge them or hear them. But Heavenly Father, we apply them to our lives. So speak to us through your word this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. Matthew 5, verse 14 says, you are the light of the world. You cannot hide a city on a mountain. Men do not light a lamp and put it under a basket. They put it on the table so that it gives light to all in the house. And the question that I would have to you this morning, where is your table? If the light is placed upon the table so that it gives light to everyone in the room, where has God placed your light? Let your light shine in front of men, and then they will see the good things that you do and will honor your Father who is in heaven. And I'll paraphrase, let them see the evidence of your faith, because faith always has an evidence. There's always an evidence to faith. Let them see the evidence of your faith. Let them see the light in you, and they will glorify your Father who is in heaven. As we read this scripture, sitting on a hill, we have a picture of a light in a prominent place. Prominent. Jesus didn't say you are the light of the church. He said you are the light of the world. Intentionally built, intentionally placed in a prominent place on a hill. A place that is noticeable. A place that is obvious. A place that is conspicuous. God has made us, as believers, conspicuous. What we do, what we say, how we live, how we conduct ourselves, how we do our jobs is conspicuous. You see, a child of God is the best employee that an employer has. Boy, that was weak.
Amen. Thank you.
A child of God, a born-again believer, is the best employee that an employer has. Because we don't work for ourselves, and we don't even work for the employer. We work for the glory of God. But it's a prominent place. Place, a strategic place, intentionally placed. We call it here at Braeswood, we call it our maximum impact environment. It's that place that God has strategically placed you, where you have the greatest potential to make the greatest impact for the kingdom of God. It's not an accident that you work where you work. It's not an accident that you live where you live. It's not an accident that you go to the school that you go to. Oh, you may have been zoned to that school. You may have got an education that opened the door. But I'm just here to tell you, if the steps of the righteous are ordered of the Lord, and they are, then God has placed you where you are. That's your table. Your job is your table. Your home is your table. Your neighborhood is your table. And the Bible says he puts that light right in the middle of that table so that it brings light to everyone in the house, everyone in your maximum impact environment. But God has strategically placed you. There are no accidents. I don't believe in luck. I don't have luck. I'm abundantly blessed by God. I don't believe that things happen. I believe that God orders things in my life. And God knows. God has a plan. God has a plan for every person in this room today. If you're a new believer, God has a plan for you. If you're a believer for 100 years, God has a plan for your life. Bible tells us early in Scripture, I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. You'll never hear God say, oh, I didn't think about that. You'll never hear uttered out of God's mouth, well, we didn't plan for that event. Uh-uh. God knows exactly what he's doing. And God knows exactly where he's taking you every single day. And the Bible says all things work together for our good because we choose God's will, God's purposes, and God's plans. So your maximum impact environment is that place that God is looking for the light to shine. It's almost as though God has said, in this job, it's dark. In this job, there are hopeless people. There are people that have been put upon, people that have been downcast, people that have been set upon, people that are hopeless. Right here in this job, I need to have a light here. Who can I send? Oh, here's Bob. I'm going to send Bob, and I'm going to put him right on the table, right in the middle of that job. Remember, I've told you, I've had people in the past have come to me and say, Pastor Steve, I'm working in a job where nobody loves Jesus there. Everybody's a heathen. Everybody hates God, and I have to work in that. Pray that God will give me a job where everybody's a believer. And I used to pray, God, open the door for a Christian job. Then it dawned on me, if they're the only light in that house, what happens if the light goes out? Where is the hope for that place where those who are lost? We are the light of the world. That's what the word says. It's an intentional place that God has placed us. And I'm encouraging us this morning, let's be the light. Shine brightly. It may be just a flicker of a small little candle, but let that candle. I'm just telling you, if you're in a dark place where there is no light, that one little candle can light up the whole room. That one little candle can make a difference. So while we're looking to do big things for God, why don't we just choose to do what needs to be done right here? Right here in my maximum impact environment. A city on a hill represents, number one, visibility. A city on a hill is visible. For those of you that have flown in airplanes at night, 30,000 feet in the air, 25,000 feet in the air at nighttime, it is dark. When you're flying over a secluded area and there's no light on the ground at all, it is dark. You look out the window, it's just dark. And if you were to fly over a city and there was a light shortage or a power surge and all the lights had gone off, you'd miss the city. You wouldn't see it. You wouldn't be able to make it out. But if there were lights in the city, sometimes we can see the streets because of the street lights. We can see businesses because of the business lights, parking lights. Sometimes we can even see car lights as they're navigating through the roads. How can we see the city? Because the lights are on. Your life is visible. People are watching your life. People are watching you. That's why a lot of Christians don't want people to know they're believers. I don't want anybody to know I'm a believer because I mess up all the time. Well, you probably do. But what happens when people see you have messed up and then you pick yourself up again and you start walking in faith? What happens when people see you stumble? What happened when Peter began to sink in the water? The other 11 men in the boat were watching him. But they didn't watch Peter sink until he drowned. They watched Peter sink and reach up to Jesus, and Jesus reached down to him and lift him right back up again. They're watching our lives. They're watching the light of Christ in us. And yeah, you're going to blow it. I'm not prophesying. I just know you. You're going to blow it. That's okay. I'm not saying we should try to blow it. God forbid. But when we fail, we get right back up again. We brush ourselves off, and we set our face straight before us in the line, looking to Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith. Visibility. Isaiah chapter 9, verse 2 says, "The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of the shadow of death, the light has dawned." And that's speaking prophetically of Christ. However, it also speaks of my life. I was once walking in darkness, but I saw a great light. And that great light changed me. And now I walk as a child of the light. You are the only hope. Hear me this morning. You are the only hope for your family. You are the only hope for your neighbors. You are the only hope for your coworkers, for your friends, for your fellow students. You are the hope of the world. That is, Christ in you is the hope of the world. The light of Jesus in you shining in that classroom is the hope to those who have no hope. Secondly, a city on a hill represents hope. Hope. Anytime there's light, it radiates hope. Several Sundays ago, you remember the lights went out. We had a power surge here. It was last Sunday, wasn't it? Or Sunday before last, a power surge, and all of the lights went out. And I had to preach that whole sermon without a microphone. How many of you remember that? Whole sermon without a microphone. Thank God for these guys who do a great job, and for those that fixed sound system. Thank you. Lights went out, and we had light that came through the windows. I had asked them to keep the shades up so that we could see the light, and that was, a prophetic thing that day. But light always brings hope. If this room was completely dark and I had a little pin light, little flashlight, we would be able to navigate through this darkened room because of that light. Little light, just a little light. I love two programs on TV. I love the History Channel and the Discovery Channel. Love those channels. And particularly the Discovery Channel, there was a program called Survivor Man. Anybody ever see that program? Survivor Man. The man's name was Les Stroud. He was a man's man. I mean, this guy, special forces in the military. I mean, he could do anything. This guy eats bugs. And they would take this man with a pocket knife and maybe a couple other utensils, very small, usually what he could put in his pocket. He always carried these big cameras along with him. And they would put him out in the middle of the wilderness, out in the middle of nowhere. I saw him in, I don't know, Antarctica or somewhere, out in the jungles, out in the bios. I mean, just out in no place. And he would have to navigate his way for days until he was able to get out. One time, just to tell you the kind of man that this is, one time he was in a desolate area. I think it was near Argentina or in Argentina, at a lake. And there nobody around the lake at all, very secluded area. And there happened to be, as he was scavenging for food, he happened to see along the lake a dead fish. Apparently, a large bird, a hawk or an eagle or something, came down, grabbed the bird, took it to the shore, and began eating it, had its full, and left it. Well, he didn't have anything to eat. So he ate that dead fish. That dead, decaying, smelly fish. That's what kind of man this is. And whenever night begins to come, dusk in the night, one of the first things he'll do is build a fire. First things he'll do. Sometimes he rubs sticks together. Sometimes he has a little flint and he'll cause a spark. But however he creates it, he creates a fire. And here's a big man. Here's a guy that fights alligators. I mean, just a big guy. He bites nails in half. A big guy. And I have seen this big guy start a fire and dance around the fire. Woohoo! Like a little kid. Why? Because fire brings hope. Light brings hope. With a fire, with light, you can cook a dead fish. And it tastes a little bit better, I think. With a fire, you can keep warm. Hope. With a fire, at nighttime, you can see things around you that you wouldn't have seen otherwise. You see, fire, light, always brings hope. It brings the ability to navigate through difficult circumstances in our lives. Light brings hope. And where God has strategically placed you is the place that you will bring light. You'll bring light to those whose lives are hopeless. You'll bring light, hope, to those who have no hope in anything else. Light to those who have tried a lot of different things and nothing seems to work. In fact, some who have even tried church and religion didn't work. But they see the light of Jesus in you, and it brings hope to their life. They see the evidence of what God is doing and has done in your life, and it brings hope to them. You know, typically when a national pastor falls, there's an antagonistic relationship, an anger that results in people who don't even know God. And I'll tell you why. Because many people think if they can't do it, what in the world makes me think I can do it? We are light, and our light brings hope. Thirdly, a prominent place only requires a little bit of light. It doesn't take much. You don't have to wait until something big comes along. You don't have to wait until something significant comes along. You don't have to wait until you touch thousands of people's lives. Just a little light. A little light brings great light in the darkest of places. A light on that prominent table lights the whole house. I am the salt. I am the light. I want you to say that with me again. I am the salt of the earth. I am the light of the world. Let's say it again. I am the salt of the earth. I am the light of the world. Our theme this year is salt and light. You are the salt of the earth. You are the light of the world. As we have begun preparing for this new year, God has placed in my heart several strategies for being salt and light. Not in the huddle. You see, God has not called us to be light in the church house. He's called us to be light in our house. He's called us to be light in our jobs, schools. So we want to know, how is it that we can convey that light everywhere we go? I have several things that I want to share with you quickly. These are initiatives. These are things, and these are just a few of the things that begin today. Some of them are just for a year. Some of them are ongoing. But I want to encourage you. I'm not asking you to join today. I'm not asking you to move today. I'm asking you to pray today of how God would use you to be salt and light. Psalms chapter 18, verse 28 says, Lord, you provide the flame for my lamp. You, God, turn the darkness around me into light. How do we do that? How do we turn the darkness around us to light? The first thing we do is pray. Pray. There are many venues of prayer here at Braeswood. Every Sunday morning at 9:15 and 10:45 in that prayer chapel, there are people that are praying for you. They're praying for this service. They're praying that God would pour out His Spirit into every heart, praying for healing, praying for deliverance, praying for salvation. We have opportunities on the first Saturday prayer of every month, meeting together, congregational-led prayer. where we seek the face of God. And there are other times where we have times of corporate prayer. But the disciples tried, and that's contrary to our nature. The nature of humanity is, okay, let's do something, right? Let's get a committee together and plan to do something. And then we jump in and we want to do something, and sometimes we succeed, and sometimes we never reach up to the level that we know could be or the level that God has spoken, because there's one element that's missing, and that is prayer. Not as a discipline, but as seeking the very face of God. Prayer. Not talking about prayer, but praying. So we're going to be calling at least two sacred assemblies this year. The dates on the screen there are wrong. The first one will be at West Campus, and that's not for West Campus congregation. That's for all of us going to West Campus, and West Campus will be hosting the event. And then there will be one here at Central Campus, and that date is correct, September the 29th. We'll be meeting together. Central Campus will host the event. Hispanic Campus will come. West Campus will come, and we will join together in a time of prayer. What is sacred assembly, Pastor? Well, Joel chapter 1, verse 14 defines what a sacred assembly is. The Bible says, consecrate a fast. Call a sacred assembly. Gather the elders and all the inhabitants of the land into the house of the Lord your God and cry out to the Lord. Pray. Seek his face. So that rather than doing something, first we pray and ask God to anoint us in the doing of something. Empower us in the doing of something. So we will gather together at least twice this year from 7 o'clock in the evening till 12:30 in the morning. 4.5 hours. And I know there's something that, whoa, I can't pray 4.5 hours. I pray for 5 minutes and I'm done. Well, this is an organized time of prayer, congregational led by and large. There will be some instruction that will be given, some messages that will be given, but they'll be short in tenure because we're not talking about prayer or teaching about prayer, we're praying. There will be stations of prayer where we will gather together at different times around different places to pray and intercede over specific issues of ministry and of life, of family, of church, of city. And we will pray and we will believe that God will anoint us and empower us to do the work that he's called us to do, to be the light that he's called us to be. Sacred assembly, prayer. But not only will we pray, we will also go. How do we turn darkness into light? By our maximum impact environment prayer walks. We're going to be coordinating. April the 1st will be the first one. We'll be coordinating people to go into their neighborhoods, gather together if we live in neighborhoods together, and we will walk our neighborhood and just pray. Pray. And I'm not talking about, yay, Lord, come and destroy the wicked. No, I'm not talking about that kind of prayer. I'm not talking about a loud prayer that draws attention to the one praying. I'm just talking about walking the sidewalks and the streets of our neighborhoods and just praying that God will conquer these areas. Walking through our neighborhoods praying to demolish the walls of resistance, the walls of hesitation, the walls of fear, and to destroy the strongholds of the enemies so that our neighbors will respond to the harvest of Jesus Christ. Joshua chapter 6, verse 2 through 3 speaks of this issue. You know the story of Joshua. The Bible says, and the Lord said to Joshua, see, I have given you the city. You shall march around the city. All the men of war, you shall go around the city once. And you know the story. He marched around the city, and the walls came tumbling down. As we march around our neighborhoods, we will pray. We will seek the face of God. We will pray with understanding. We will pray in the Spirit. We will do warfare for our neighborhoods, believing that God will bring down the walls of resistance, bring down the walls of fear, bring down the walls of hesitation, that God will destroy the walls that keep people from receiving Jesus Christ and the light of Christ in their life. And not only will we be walking our neighborhoods, we will call for a prayer walk around the church, not around the building, but around the neighborhoods here, praying that God will release the harvest as well. How do we, at Braeswood Central Campus, turn the darkness into light? Connect. Connect. Personal evangelism, taking salt and light out of the huddle. You see, in just a couple of weeks, we're going to have Super Bowl right here in Houston, Texas. I don't even care who's in the Super Bowl. But they're going to play the game, right? 80,000 people aren't going to gather in that stadium to watch them get in a huddle. In fact, typically when they get in a huddle, people disengage. It's during the huddle that people talk to one another. It's during the huddle that they read the programs. It's during the huddle that they begin to look around the stadium. Sometimes it's in the huddle that they walk out to get a Coke. Or people don't go to a stadium to watch a football game and a football team in their huddle. They go to watch what happens when the team leaves the huddle. When they face the scrimmage line, when they face their opponents. And brothers and sisters, it's not about what happens in this huddle. What happens in the huddle is important, the church services. It's important. It's vital. But light is here. I said before, God has not called us to be light in the church. He's called us to be the light of the world. What happens when we leave this huddle? What happens when the enemy says, I'm not going to let you cross the goal line? What happens when there's resistance to the message of Christ? What do we do? The huddle is important, but winning happens on the field. And each and every one of us leave the huddle today, and we'll go on the field. We'll go into our maximum impact environment, and there is where the battles are won. Romans chapter 10, verse 10 through 17 says, for with the heart one believes and is justified, and with the mouth one confesses and saves. Verse 14 says, but how can people call for help if they don't know who to trust? And how can they know who to trust if they haven't heard of the one who can be trusted? And how can they hear if nobody tells them? And how is anyone going to tell them unless someone is sent to do it? When we leave the huddle this morning, we are going out into the field of life. We're going into our maximum impact environment. And I pray we're encouraged here. We worship the Lord here. Correction is made here. Plans are decided here. But when we leave here, we go out to live light into the field of play. How do we do this? We're asking everyone in the church to connect to one person every month. One person a month. One person a month where you can be the light. And perhaps even while we're thinking about this or you're contemplating this, you already know there's somebody in your life that needs the light. They're in your life. They're not somebody you have to go to and find and search out. They're right there. They're sitting around your table, the table where your light is placed. We would simple acts of faith, an invitation to a service, an invitation to a special event takes place here. But the goal of each one reaching one. Everyone reaching one person a month, just a month, 12 people a year. Goal is 365 people won to Christ in 2017. 365, that's one person a day won to Jesus Christ. Let me just report. On January the 1st, 5 people accepted Jesus Christ in the huddle. 140 accepted Christ with Brother Michael French on January the 8th. 7 accepted Christ under Lance Ivey's ministry. 12 accepted the Lord last Sunday, including at the anointing of the hands, including 2 that signed, I have rededicated my life to the Lord on their connection card. So far this year, as of before today, 164 people have accepted Jesus Christ this year already. Now, I'm going to bring a little bit of a rebuke here. You're going to hear from Papa now. When somebody receives the Lord, this is not a, oh, yay, isn't that wonderful? That's so sweet. The Bible says when one person turns to the light, all of the angelic beings of heaven rejoice. All of the angelic. Now, let me just tell you, they don't rejoice because they just decided one day, well, let's just rejoice. They rejoice because Jesus initiated the party. So that if the angelic beings rejoice, don't you know Father, Son, and Holy Spirit are rejoicing right alongside of them? And so when someone receives the Lord, when somebody's, in fact, the Bible says the great shepherd has 100 sheep, and one of them strays into the darkness. He leaves the 99. They're protected. They're cared for. They're in the cleft. But he leaves the 99. And what does he do? He goes looking for that one lost sheep. And the Bible says when he finds that sheep, what does he do? He rejoices. And here's my goal. My goal is to out-rejoice heaven. My goal is to out-celebrate heaven when one person comes to Jesus Christ. So when we announce 164 people have accepted the Lord, this place ought to explode with celebration that somebody accepted Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. So I'm going to say it again, 164 people have accepted Christ as of the beginning of this day in the month of January. Praise the Lord. Glory to God. That's the way it ought to be. We ought to rejoice in what God is doing because God saved me. And I rejoice in that. And I'll rejoice in a brother or sister coming to the Lord as well. But let me just tell you, already today, 8 people have accepted Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. 8 people have come to the Lord. And we want to double our efforts in discipleship of those who have come to the Lord. Double our efforts in an opportunity to invest in their life so that not only is this just a one-time event in their life, but this is a lifelong relationship with our living God. We will also play. You see, this is not 365 people in the huddle getting saved. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about 365 people getting saved outside of the huddle. Outside. 365 people getting saved because of our maximum impact environment. I want to ask a question here. Is the young man from Best Buy that I talked to Saturday, are you here this morning? I don't mean to embarrass you. Just raise your hand. I'll see you and that'll be the end of it. I don't see him. Friday, Don and I went to, I just want to say, when I stand here, any minister, any pastor, any teacher, anybody who shares the word of God is the filter of that word. It has to be filtered through our hearts and through our spirits first. Don and I were at Best Buy. We were looking for an MP3 player. And I don't know MP3 from MP7. I don't know, or whatever. I don't have a clue. So we walked into the store and immediately asked the lady, hadn't been to the store in years and years, asked the lady, she was there. I said, can you direct me to where the MP3 players are? And she said where it was. We walked over there and there were about, I don't know, 15 different MP3 players. And I don't know one from the other. And they've got, you know, this many gig of somethings and this many TBs or something else, and I don't know what that is. And so there was a young man standing there, worked at the store, and I said, could you help us just a minute? And he came over, and I said, I'm a pastor, and we're looking for two MP3 players, one for the prayer chapel and one for an office so that we can have music playing. I explained it to him. I'm a pastor of Braeswood Church. And so we were talking, and he had an accent. I think Donna asked him, where are you from? We do that quite often if we recognize an accent from somebody. Where are you from? And he said, I'm from Haiti. And I said, our children's ministry director pastor is from Haiti. She was born in Haiti, Sister Debbie Oyutunji. She's one of our leaders here at the church, full time. Wow. I said, really? I said, yes, we have people from, we went on and talked about the church. And so when it was over, I said, thank you so much. God bless you. And walked off. And Donna had walked off in front of me. And it just dawned on me, light. This little light of mine. So I went to Donna. I said, do you have an invitation card to Braeswood? And she said, yes. And she gave it to me. Looked for it. I went to him and I said, I want to invite you to Braeswood Church. He said, I've talked a lot about it, but I want to invite you to the church. And he said, where is it? And I said, well, it's Fondren and Willoughby. He said, I live right across the road from that. Right around the corner from that. Strategic place. Strategic. So I said, here, I want you to have this. And I would love to have you come and worship Braeswood. And by the way, Jesus loves you. And just turned around and walked away. This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. Now, he's not here today, apparently, but I'm just here to tell you. Where is he? Okay. Is that you? That's you? I can't see for these lights. Oh, it's good to see you. Hallelujah. I'm proud of you, buddy. I am proud of you. Praise the Lord. But you see, this little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. I'm going to let it shine. I believe a strategic appointment that God placed in my life happens all the time for all of us, not just me, but for all of us. This little light of mine. We're going to set in place a mechanism whereby when you lead somebody to Jesus Christ or you invite them to come to church, that you can let us know and that we can celebrate that. So that when you lead somebody to the Lord, this church, just like we did a moment ago, can celebrate that fact, that act happening from your life, from the light of your life. I've got to go quickly. How do we reach Southwest Houston, our maximum impact environment, by being light? By reach. Reach. REACH stands for Relational Evangelism and Christian Hospitality. Relational Evangelism and Christian Hospitality. What I'm looking for, God birthed this in my spirit. What I am looking for is one person to represent their nation. One person. Could be more than one, but at least one person to represent their nation. So that when guests and visitors come to Braeswood, that we can immediately connect them to somebody who is from their country. You see, here's the amazing thing. We talk about wanting to reach the world for Jesus. We talk about going to the far places, far regions of the world to reach people for Jesus Christ. And I'm here to tell you, Jesus has brought them to Houston, Texas. Did you hear what I said? Jesus, the Lord, the Spirit, has brought people from all over the world right here to our city. We don't have to walk 10 feet not to find somebody that the Lord has brought from a nation, from a place, from a region right here in this city. We don't have to journey very far and touch the entire world. But I'm looking for one person to represent every nation, somebody from Nigeria, somebody from Ghana, somebody from Guatemala, and even somebody from South Dakota. Well, there are people that come to Braeswood from all parts of the United States as well. Typically, after service, people will come up to me, and if I detect an accent, I'll ask them, where are you from? And they will tell me. And if there's somebody around me who is from that same country or region, if they're, I'll introduce them to that person, and immediately there's a connection. There's a relational connection. Where are you from? I'm from Lagos, Nigeria. Here, I want you to meet somebody here. They're from Lagos as well. And immediately you know the same streets, you know the same stores, you know the same. You have something in common. There's a relationship that's built there. When somebody comes from a nation that I don't recognize as a worshiper from Braeswood, I always tell them this: you're an answer to prayer. You represent your nation in this church. You see, before the Lord calls me home, I want to experience something. I don't know that there are too many people in the world who have ever experienced this, but I want to experience being under one roof where there's somebody from every nation on earth worshiping Almighty God. Now, I know that's going to happen when I get to heaven, but I want a little heaven to get there with. And you see, that's not beyond the realm of possibility. That is so possible, and especially for we who live in Houston, Texas. But somebody comes to the church from a nation, and we can connect them with somebody else from that nation, and if not from that nation, from at least the region, so that they have something in common. And I'm not talking about segregating people off, you know, we're trying to separate this from that. No, I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about just making and building relationships together. And I'm looking for people who are willing to say, I'll be for Ghana. I'll be that person. To where we may have places in the foyer where there are people that sit at a table waiting for somebody to come to them and talk to them and share with them, be a friend to them. Something that's going to happen in this church very soon. Pastor Zeke is going to lead us in a song in this service, a song that everybody knows, a song that perhaps is known all around the world. And we're going to ask you to sing that song in your language. Not to sing it in English, but to sing it in your language. So that at least whether there's 20 or 30 or 40 or 50 different nations represented in this place, during that service, we will hear the sounds of heaven. All worshiping God, different languages, but all worshiping God the exact same way. And can I tell you something? That'd be second on my list from one person in every nation under one roof. Ask of me, and I will give you the nations as your inheritance. And see, not only do we have an opportunity to touch the nations here in Houston, did you know? And I don't know if it's now. I read an article about this several months ago. I don't know if it's happening right now recall that it said it was, or it's going to happen soon, but I believe that Houston is the number one most diverse city in the nation. Number one, exceeding New York City. The number one most diverse city in the United States. Houston, Texas. God has brought the world to our back door. And if God has, and God is saying, sons and daughters of Houston, I trust you. I trust you. I trust you to be light to those that come from no background of Christianity whatsoever. I trust you to be the light in their life. I've brought them to you so that you would be the light of Christ. And I'm encouraging everyone who represents a nation where there's only you representing that nation, I encourage you, you bring somebody with you. Bring somebody from your nation with you here to Braeswood. Somebody that doesn't have a church home, somebody that's not worshiping anywhere right now. We're not trying to steal sheep, but bring them with you and introduce them to the life that is Braeswood. I want to encourage you this morning. Tell you how this works. When I grew up in right outside of San Francisco, and we moved from San Francisco to Cleveland, Texas, an East Texas town. Good people, country people, but good people. And I would walk through the halls of the school, and people would come up to me and say, "Say something." "What? Say something." "Well, what do you want me to say?" "Say anything." "Mary had a little lamb, its fleece was white as snow." And I asked one person, "Why are you asking me this? Why are you bugging me?" That was the word we used back then. "Why are you bugging me?" "Because you talk funny. You have an accent." I didn't have an accent. They had the accent. But see, that accent conveys something. But we're not just talking about the different nations of the world. We're also talking about the different areas of the United States. To represent that, and not to represent Braeswood, but to represent the kingdom of God. This is not about Braeswood. It's not about building a church. It's about building God's kingdom. Last thing I will share, that's this. How do we reach the world? Walking in the Spirit. It is God's will for every born-again believer to be baptized in the Holy Spirit. I believe that. Every believer baptized in the Holy Spirit. And if you're here this morning and you're not baptized in the Holy Spirit, begin to seek the Lord to give you not what you earn, not what you deserve, but a gift that is given to you. Jesus said, "I've spoken about this. You will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be my lights." Power of the Holy Spirit, not only the ministry of the Holy Spirit, the power of the Holy Spirit, but the gifts of the Holy Spirit functioning in our life every day. Every day. Not just at church, but everywhere we go. Whatever we do and called to do. We will have a connection small group in the summer that will be teaching about receiving the baptism of the Holy Spirit, and we'll go on to study the gifts of the Spirit as well and their function within the believer and within the body of Christ. We will have trained counselors who will lead people in after services, during our prayer time, after services, leading people in the baptism of the Holy Spirit. We will have special guests who will be coming to us that will be gifted in leading people and teaching people about ministry and gifts of the Spirit. All of that will take place in the context of desiring every born-again believer to be baptized in the Holy Spirit. It's for you. It's for every one of us. Not because we're great, perfect, or deserve it, but because God said, "This is my gift that I'm giving to you." Would you bow your heads with me, please? Father, there are so many things that are the context of this year to become light. Not just light in the huddle, but light on the playing field as well. Light in the darkness. Father, all of this only takes place as we have a personal relationship with you. None of it happens because we're good. None of it happens because we've joined an organization. Nothing of this happens because we are born in a certain family or a certain place. It's a personal relationship with you. Father, you have never been about religion. You have always been about relationship. And Father, you have made everything so simple. Humanity makes everything complicated. A simple concept becomes greatly complex and complicated when humanity gets involved. But Heavenly Father, you have made salvation so simple. You have said in your word, come unto me all you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. You didn't say, come unto me all you who are rich. Come unto me all you who are powerful. Come unto me all you who have gifts and talents and abilities. No, you said who are weary, and I will give you rest. So, Father, in this place this morning, there may be somebody that doesn't have a relationship with you. We're not talking about joining the church. We're not talking about being religious. We're not talking about following a charismatic leader. We're not talking about paying for something. We're not talking about doing something or stop doing something. We're just talking about in this moment coming and saying, Jesus, I need help. Acknowledging that I've done wrong. Lord, I'm a sinner. I'm messed up. But also praying, Father, forgive me of my sin. Forgive me of the wrong that I've done in my life. Forgive me of the mistakes that I've made, the wrong turns. Forgive me of the sin in my life. Father, forgive me. And the Bible says, as simple as it can say, you are faithful, trustworthy, and will forgive us of all of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And so, Heavenly Father, this morning I pray, there are some people that have come into this church today because they know they need help. They know their life isn't right. Prodigals that are coming back. Prodigals that acknowledge, I knew God. I love the Lord. I was a bright, shining light at one time. But the light went out. But today they're coming back. Those, Heavenly Father, that have never served you, never walked with you, never had the light of Christ in their life are coming today to say, I need help. I'm tired of existing. I'm tired of surviving. I'm tired of just barely getting by. I'm tired of the merry-go-round of life. I need help. Lord, help me. And with that simple prayer, Heavenly Father begins a miraculous work. Forgiveness, transformation, change. As every head is bowed and every eye closed, I ask this question. It is the apex. It is the top of this service tonight, and that is today. That is this. Do you have a personal daily relationship with Jesus Christ? I'm not talking about joining a church. I'm not talking about being religious. Do you have a personal daily relationship with Jesus Christ? And the beauty of that question is nobody has to tell you. I don't have to tap you on the shoulder and say, it's you, it's you, it's you. No, we know in our heart. We know if we've been playing games. We know if we've been playing religion. We know if we've been lost. We know if we've been separated. We know if we've been turned away. We know. If you're here this morning and you say, Pastor Steve, I need help in my life. Pastor Steve, I need to be forgiven of my sin. Pastor Steve, I need a relationship with God. I'm not asking you to join the church. I'm asking you simply to pray a simple prayer. And pray it honestly. If you're here today and you need Jesus Christ in your life, if you're here today and you need to be forgiven of sin, I want you to just raise your hand, wave at me. This is not to join a church. I want to pray with you. God bless you. Anybody else? Just wave at me. God bless you. Thank you. Anybody else? I believe this is your... Thank you. Thank you. God bless you. Hands. Thank you. Praise the Lord. Good. See, this is the best decision you could make in your life. If you didn't raise your hand already, I want you to simply lift your hand. Thank you. Thank you. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. We're going to pray a prayer now. Thank you. We're going to pray a prayer now. If you raised your hand and you're honest and sincere, you see, God knows our heart. We can't play games with God. I can't fake him out. I can't lie to him. He knows it all. But I can be honest. And if you honestly make that confession, we're going to pray in just a minute. And it's not just repeating a prayer. It's that you make this prayer your prayer. You make it yours. You take ownership of it. We're going to pray together. And we're all going to pray together this prayer. In agreement with those that are praying for the first time or prodigals coming home, let's pray together. I want everyone to repeat after me. Heavenly Father, today, January 29th, 2017, I ask you to forgive me of all my sins. Forgive me of everything I've ever done wrong. Forgive me of everything I've done against you. I ask you, Heavenly Father, to change my life, cleanse my life, and as I receive you as my Savior, declaring that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, Jesus Christ is my Savior. I receive forgiveness now. And I receive it by faith. And I declare I am a child of God. I declare I am light. And today is a new beginning in my life. Transformation, change, and I'll never be the same again. I give you my life. I give you my dreams. I give you my failures. And I receive you as my Savior. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Come on, give the Lord a praise offering.